As you may or may not already know, there was a test screening for Dune in 2020, which I already spoke about in my video, Dune Movie Test Screening Reactions, which you can check out. But there have been two interviews from people who have actually attended the Dune test screening. In-depth interviews, with many questions asked and many questions answered. So in this video, we're going to take a look at what was said. So of course this video is going to contain spoilers for the Dune film, so if you do not wish to be spoiled, please watch another video of mine. A discussion with one of those who attended the Dune test screening was on 4chan in a large thread with a lot of other nonsense added into the mix, so I've taken out the best points for you to sum it up. Of course this information is subject to change, but this is the information as it stands at the moment based on what those people saw at the Dune test screening. The movie is estimated at 2 hours 15 minutes, including credits. They described the film as feeling like the time when they watched Fellowship of the Ring in the theatres. Now to compare Dune to the Fellowship of the Ring is quite a big comparison, because the Fellowship of the Ring began the Lord of the Rings franchise essentially, in games, in their new TV series, and the Fellowship of the Ring was a good movie. I mean, it was a genre-defining fantasy film, so to compare Dune to Fellowship of the Ring is something positive. They say that the Jessica character is great, they say Oscar Isaac is also great, and that a lot of people will like Oscar Isaac's character, Duke Leto, because it's the first time we get to see him act like this. And his later performance is a great performance. The Baron is lots of fun, Paul is great, but they say that the weakest character is Gurney Halleck's character, perhaps due to the way he's portrayed or the amount of screen time he has, etc. They even liked Duncan and Thufir Hawat, so they liked Stephen Henderson and Jason Momoa's performances. And David Dasmalchin, if I remember correctly, they really liked how he was sinister in it. They also mentioned that Stilgar is really cool, and that's something that makes me happy, because Stilgar is a representation of the Fremen, and when he was cast, I was pleased that a Fremen was cast with an Oscar-winning actor in Javier Bardem. So I'm really looking forward to Javier Bardem's performance, and that's one of those performances that I'm most looking forward to in Denis Villeneuve's Dune. The movie ends with Pink Floyd's Eclipse, performed in a slightly different way by Hans Zimmer to the version that we get to hear in the trailer and the version that he released online. So Pink Floyd's Eclipse is the last track we hear as the movie ends. Apparently the soundtrack is amazing and it feels alien. So I'm looking forward to seeing what Hans Zimmer has cooked up. And this person who answered the questions gave the movie 10 out of 10, said that it is a movie that if someone didn't know what Dune was and then they watched the Dune movie, they would come out loving it. So this has the potential to create new fans, a lot more new fans. And the audience that watched it with this person said they all loved it. And now comes the controversial points, some of the interesting things that was said about the film, which are strange, weird, perhaps negative, who knows. Let me know what you think in the comment section below. And this is just a reminder that if you like these videos, I would really appreciate a like, share and subscribe. If you'd like to see more videos like this, you can support me on my Patreon and you can become a channel member by clicking on the join button. Now that that is out of the way, let's get back to the Dune news. So, spoiler alert, before we get onto this, again, another spoiler alert. This is if you haven't seen any previous iterations of Dune or read the books and wish to remain spoiler free, please consider watching another video of mine. This will contain spoilers. Dr. Yui's death is very interesting. Apparently he's killed by a fork, and this matches what is in the script. The Baron is feasting on a platter with a fork and a carving knife, so he must use the fork to kill Yui. And the way he kills Yui is that he decapitates him, which is going to be a very gory scene. Perhaps it would have even pushed it to a higher rating, but I think they may have toned down certain things to keep it a PG-13. Irulan isn't in the film at all. Neither is the Emperor or Fade. They are all mentioned in the film, but they are not seen at all. So, there is no surprise show-up of Fade at the end. There is no post-end credit scene with Fade making an appearance. Nothing of the sort. He's not in the film, he hasn't been cast, and he won't make an appearance. Unless they really do surprise us all and throw it in there, but I highly doubt it. Sticking with the Baron, two teens, one male and one female, are implied to have been raped by the Baron. Now, this is probably from a scene that is in the script where these two teens are attending the Baron, they're at him side by side as servants or something of the sort. And I think this is when he emerges from the oil slick bath, that same scene we see in the trailer. I think as far as his sexuality is concerned, I think this is the only element that we're going to get to imply his leanings. Now, there has been talk about whether the film is good enough to stand alone and have no sequel and works as a standalone film. This person seems to get the feeling that it is a film which ends on a good note, it ends on a hopeful note. The scene with Chani and Paul, with the Water of Life, goes back to his vision of her. So it kind of comes around full circle, again the circle motif, symbol of the eclipse, and the circle of fire. But they do say that the film leaves a lot of things that are unanswered. For example, there is an Atreides soldier who goes to Gedi Prime as a slave, and he had a pretty big role, and this is probably a setup for the sequel, which may or may not ever get made. Again, this mirrors what happens in the script. There is such a character, and you get the feeling that other things go unanswered, such as the Emperor storyline, Fade, and the fact that the Harkonnens win, but Paul doesn't get any kind of justice for what happens to his house. So it really is half the storyline. It seems that the color grading is, as seen in the trailer. There may be no change at all. So it may be that those scenes, those dark, subtle grays, those dimly lit desert scenes are what we're going to get to see in the final film. There seems to be no change between the trailer and the movie, according to those who are actually at the test screening. Something that I find interesting is that one of these people who attended the test screening was asked about an image that I shared of an ornithopter which was covered in violet light. Now, this image is untreated, as is, the lighting is exactly as it was in the image that I shared. Untreated and unchanged, this is natural light. So perhaps this didn't make the final cut, or perhaps it hasn't even been included in the film yet. But I thought that that was interesting because the person said they don't recall seeing a scene like that with that kind of imagery, with that kind of color in that ornithopter. So I find that quite strange. The second Q&A with a person who attended the test screening for Dune said the following. They loved the film, everything was pretty much perfect, and bearing in mind this person is unfamiliar with the source material, this is a fresh reaction from someone just getting into Dune for the first time. They think it will absolutely be the definitive Dune adaptation, but they didn't like it as much as they liked Blade Runner 2049, but it's very close, according to them. They gave the film 9 out of 10, and when asked about if there was any complaint about the film, the only complaint that they would give is that there is at times a little too much information to take in, but they could understand it enough that it didn't ruin the film experience. The Dune cinematography is completely opposite to Blade Runner 2049. They were aware that people were concerned whether the film would be dull or not, but that the film is really beautiful. The set design is gorgeous, such a beautiful looking film. The pictures that were released don't do the film justice, according to them. The movie has its own distinct style, and the lighting is very naturalistic. And they mentioned that they left the screening wanting to see more. They love David Desmalchin's performance. He looks incredibly pale, with no eyebrows, and has a line on his lips, which is obviously the stained lips of a Mentat. But they wished that he got more screen time. They also confirmed that the scene with Idaho fighting to save Jessica and Paul is in the trailer, so this must be the scene where he eventually dies. Again, they loved Oscar Isaac's performance as Duke Leto, and they found Stellan Skarsgård's Baron very intimidating, with his deep voice, and they compare him to Snoke, which is obviously something that we heard previously. The architecture is very brutalist, It reminds them of the Wallace Court building in Blade Runner 2049, and that's the closest thing that resembles the Arrakis building, which will obviously be Arrakeen. The sets are grand and impressive, and that you really haven't seen most of it at all. The VFX, the costume work, the production design, the soundtrack and cinematography were all Oscar-worthy, according to them. And this mirrors what the previous person who saw the test screen said, that there's basically lots of things that we haven't seen yet in merchandise or promos, very cool stuff, so we have things to look forward to. Concerning the score, they say that Hans Zimmer brings his A-game to this film, so that's quite exciting to hear. There's a lot of chanting and creepy alien sounds. It felt like an assault on the ears, according to them. Again, they confirm that the film ends after the Water of Life scene, with Charney saying, "This is just the beginning," or "This is only the beginning," or something to that effect, and that the ending is very much set up for a sequel. They mention how lasgun beams feature like Star Wars blasters, white beams of light, and they mention how Leto's death scene and the scene where Paul destroys the Hunter Seeker are among their favourite scenes. The Fremen walking without rhythm is described as a dance, and the Fremen do this throughout the film. As I noted, the shots in a previous video of the walking without rhythm, the footprints in the sand, gave it away. So that's what I have for you all. If you like this video, please don't forget to like, share and subscribe, and click the bell so that you can be first to be notified of new videos. If you enjoy my channel and wish to see more, you can support me on my Patreon, or join as a channel member, where you will receive access to exclusive content, video releases ahead of time, secret content, and more. Thank you to my Patreons and my channel members for your support. And until next time, see you soon.